Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Choice Theory, a very short introduction, by Michael Allingham. Narrated by Mike Cooper. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you'll hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. Albert Einstein introduces his brilliant exposition, Relativity, in the following terms. The present book is intended, as far as possible, to give an exact insight into the theory of relativity to those readers who, from a general scientific and philosophical point of view, are interested in the theory, but who are not conversant with the mathematical apparatus of theoretical physics. The work presumes a standard of education corresponding to that of a university matriculation examination, and, despite the shortness of the book, a fair amount of patience and force of will on the part of the reader. The author has spared himself no pains in his endeavour to present the main ideas in the simplest and most intelligible form. May the book bring someone a few happy hours of suggestive thought. Apart from substituting choice for relativity and logic for physics, I can find no better way to express the aim of this book. Choice theory explores the reasoning which underlines coherent patterns of choice. It explores what it means to act rationally. Why is this important? As Aristotle reminds us, the origin of action is choice, and that of choice is desire and reasoning. Good action, and its opposite, cannot exist without a combination of intellect and character. Choice theory develops the intellectual reasoning which is necessary for good action. The character, which is also necessary for this, is up to you. The book is short not because it covers a small territory, but because it does not go into exhaustive detail of the territory which it does cover. Many interesting sites are mentioned, but in many cases only incomplete directions are given for finding them. The book is more a guide than a gazetteer. Many arguments are missing or only sketched. The listener may like to supply or complete these, and would do well to do so where this is suggested by phrases such as, "It is easy to see that." The notes at the end of the book indicate where help may be found, and also warn of the ascents which even the more intrepid explorer might be unwise to attempt. A number of open questions and paradoxes are raised but not resolved, though guidelines which might help the listener find his own resolution are indicated. The listener must take his own views on such matters. I'm grateful to Shelley Cox of Oxford University Press for suggesting that I write this book and for commenting on the manuscript, and to those of my family and friends who, too, have provided comments. I'm also grateful to the University of Siena for providing an ideal ambience in which to reflect on the underlying ideas, and to Magdalen College for giving me a period of leave in which to transform these into words. Chapter 1. Choice and Desire. Choose life. Choose a job. Choose a career. Choose a family. Choose a big television. Choose washing machines, cars, compact disc players and electrical tin openers. Choose good health, low cholesterol and dental insurance. Choose fixed interest mortgage repayments. Choose a starter home. Choose your friends. Choose leisure wear and matching luggage. Choose a three-piece suite on hire purchase. Choose your future. Choose life. But why should I want to do a thing like that? I chose not to choose life. I chose something else. And the reasons? There are no reasons. Who needs reasons? Thus, the opening voiceover of the film Trainspotting. But is the speaker, one Renton, choosing rationally? His choice of something else rather than life is his concern. It may not be my choice or yours, but it cannot by itself be irrational. De gustibus non disputandum est, as they say. But his claiming to have no reason is a different matter, for, as language suggests, and as we shall see, there is an intimate connection between reason and rationality. Indeed, Renton himself soon provides a reason. People think it's all about misery and desperation and death and all that shite, which is not to be ignored, but what they forget is the pleasure of it. Otherwise we wouldn't do it. After all, we're not stupid. At least, we're not that stupid. And with enviable practicality, he continues. When you're on junk, you have only one worry, scoring. When you're off it, you have to worry about all sorts of other shite. Got no money? Can't get pished. Got money? Drinking too much. Can't get a bird? No chance of a ride. Got a bird? Too much hassle. You have to worry about bills, about food, about some football team that never wins, about human relationships and all the things that really don't matter. All choices, just as Renton's, arise from both the heart and the head. The heart provides the passion and the head the reasons. Choices based on the most minute reasoning, but lacking any desire, are vacuous. But desire without reason is impotent. It is fit only for the enraged child who wants both to go home and not to go home. Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, the founder of choice theory, and indeed of logic itself, identifies the connection. The origin of choice is desire and reasoning with a view to an end. This is why choice cannot exist without reason. Or, more precisely, choice is deliberate desire. And David Hume, 1711 to 76, that beacon of the Scottish Enlightenment, famously claims that reason is, and ought only to be, the slave of the passions. Passions themselves, even Renton's, are neither reasonable nor unreasonable. A passion can never, in any sense, be called unreasonable. Thus, it is not contrary to reason to prefer the destruction of the whole world to the scratching of my finger. It is not contrary to reason for me to choose my total ruin to prevent the least uneasiness of an Indian. A framework. Reasonableness is a property of patterns of choices, not of individual choices. There is nothing irrational in wanting to go home, but there is something amiss in wanting both to go home and not to go home. There is nothing irrational in Renton's choosing heroin, but his choice looks odd if he also chooses to avoid the possibility of misery, desperation, and death. Thus, to explore what it means to be rational, we must look at patterns of choices. We must look at the way in which choice changes when the menu changes. This framework of menus and choices needs some explanation. By a menu, I mean a list of items from which choice must be made. But unlike a restaurant menu, a menu in our sense is set out in such a way that something must be chosen. A simple restaurant menu might be sandwiches, avocado, bacon. This would allow the replete to choose nothing and the hungry to choose both. The corresponding menu in our sense would be items, nothing, avocado alone, bacon alone, both. Now, by construction, some item must be chosen, even if that item is the one labelled nothing. However, we must allow for ties, that is, for more than one item to be chosen jointly. For example, avocado alone may tie with bacon alone. To say that these two items tie, or are chosen jointly, is just to say that we are equally content with either. It does not mean that we consume both. In the face of a tie, you may imagine that we rely on some arbitrary tiebreaker, such as tossing a coin, and then consume the winner. Without this artificial device, we could find ourselves in the same position as Buridan's ass, the creature of the scholastic philosopher Jean Buridan, 1295 to 1358. This unfortunate animal, placed midway between two identical bales of hay, starved to death because he had no reason for moving one way rather than the other. As an illustration of the way in which rationality may be found or not found in patterns of choices, consider the sandwich menu. Faced with this, you choose avocado. There can be nothing irrational in this. However, when the waiter arrives to take your order, he tells you that cheese is also available. The effect of this is that you now have a three-item menu: avocado, bacon, and cheese. You choose bacon. Again, there can be nothing irrational in this individual choice. But there is clearly something untoward in your pattern of choices. Your choice changes when the menu is enlarged by the addition of something which you do not want, namely cheese. I shall, throughout the book, assume that there are sufficient items for the problem not to be trivial. For example, I shall ignore menus which consist of only one item. I shall also, except where this cannot be avoided, assume that all menus are finite. This latter assumption rules out two classes of choices. An example of the first class is that of choosing a number of dollars without restriction. The problem here is that there are infinitely many discrete amounts: $1, $2, $3, and so forth. This class can be ruled out without qualm, as almost all interesting choice menus have some upper and lower limits. An example of the second class is that of choosing the temperature of a bath, say within the range 10 to 60 degrees centigrade. Here, the menu obviously has an upper and a lower limit, but the temperature can vary continuously between these. Ruling out this class causes no practical problems. We lose nothing of substance if we restrict our choice to temperatures which vary in increments of, say, 0.1 degrees. If we do this, our menu has only a finite number of items. In addition, I shall in the main assume that choice is timeless. This is not as restrictive as it may seem, as most choices involving time can be expressed in a timeless way. For example, you can commit yourself today to choosing avocado today and bacon tomorrow, which is clearly a choice involving time. You can also commit yourself today to choosing bacon tomorrow if it's raining tomorrow, or if Pegasus wins the derby, or if I've chosen bacon today. In each of these examples, time enters the picture only in an inessential way. However, as we shall see, not all choices fit this pattern. Some settings. In the remainder of the book, I explore what it means to choose rationally in various settings. I start by exploring reason and rationality in the simplest context, that where menus consist of definite items, such as avocado and $100. This context also applies to choices such as where to live and who to spend the rest of your life with. Drawing on this, I turn to the setting where menus consist of chance items or gambles, both those where probabilities are given, such as $100 if red comes up, typified by roulette, and those where probabilities are not given, such as avocado if Pegasus wins the derby, typified by racing. The discussion here applies to choices such as, in the first case, whether to undergo an operation if you're told that the mortality rate is 25%, and in the second, whether to travel by air in the face of terrorist threats. As a digression, I then consider a special case of this setting, that where chance items involve only money. In this case, attitudes to risk, as manifest in gambling and insurance, become relevant. This digression applies particularly to choices such as which form to hold your wealth in and whether to insure your house. Returning to the main story, I consider the case where menus consist of strategic items, such as making a high or a low auction bid, or, more generally, conflict or cooperation. The discussion here applies to choices such as when to travel, if you know that everyone else is trying to avoid the rush hour, and, for a nation, whether to develop a nuclear capability when others face the same choice. The discussion thus far is that of individual choice. I conclude with a discussion of group choice, exploring mechanisms such as democracy and dictatorship for achieving this. This discussion applies to matters such as the choice of a restaurant by a group of friends, and, on a larger scale, the relative advantages of first past the post and proportional representation in elections. The connections between these settings are illustrated in the figure. In the core discussion in each setting, I proceed in four stages. First, I give some examples in which something seems amiss. An instance might be the sandwich example discussed before. Second, I suggest what general problems might lie behind these examples. In the sandwich example, I suggest that what is wrong is that your choice changes when the menu is enlarged by the addition of something which you do not want. Third, I propose as a condition for rational choice that such problems should not arise. This, in effect, defines what it means to be rational. In the sandwich example, the condition might be that the addition to the menu of some irrelevant item should not affect your choice, and choice would then be considered to be rational if it satisfied this condition. In fact, as we shall see, this condition, although necessary, is not sufficient for choice to be considered rational. Fourth, I find a procedure for achieving choice which is rational in this sense. That is, I provide a characterization of rational choice. In the sandwich context, the characterization might be that your choice is rational if, and only if, you can list all the items in some order and choose those at the top of your list. A summary of the discussion of these four stages is given at the end of the relevant chapter. As well as repeating the main points, this provides, in addition to the glossary, a convenient place in which to refer to various definitions. Having dealt with the core ideas in each setting, I look more briefly at some extensions. I start by making some observations on how, if at all, the story changes if time enters the picture in an essential way. I then present what is claimed to be an empirical paradox. This is typically an instance where people taking part in laboratory experiments appear to act irrationally. There are a number of possible responses to such paradoxes. First, we can presume that people act differently when faced with real or significant choices than when faced with artificial or insignificant ones. You may take more care if what is at risk is your house rather than a mere $10 reward. Second, we can accept that we all make mistakes from time to time. The fact that you negligently make an irrational choice does not imply that you would keep to it if its irrationality were pointed out to you. Third, we may interpret choice theory as an exploration of what it means to be rational and, possibly, as a guide to making sensible decisions rather than as a description of how people act in practice. Fourth, we can attempt to revise the theory to take account of the paradox. However, revising the theory to resolve one particular paradox may well create more problems than it solves. The maxim, hard cases make bad law, should be borne in mind. You should formulate your own response to each of these paradoxes. I conclude, as an application of choice theory, with a discussion of whether this theory throws any light on what might be meant by a just distribution of wealth, that is, on what is known as distributive justice. Indeed, the implications of choice theory for distributive justice may be considered a subplot of the main story. As I have noted, we may interpret choice theory either as an exploration of what it means to be rational or as a description of how people act in practice. If we adopt the latter interpretation, we should not confuse a description with an explanation. The claim would not be that people deliberately carry out the various calculations which the theory might suggest, just that, on the whole, they act as if they do. A good description of the way in which a tree grows is obtained by assuming that it develops leaves in a way which maximizes the area exposed to the sun, but not even a tree hugger would seriously suggest that the tree does this deliberately. If we interpret choice theory as an exploration of what it means to be rational, then the theory may also serve as a guide to making sensible decisions. But it will not, for example, suggest that you should gamble or that you should insure, for individual choices cannot be reasonable or unreasonable. It might, however, suggest that you would be unwise to do both. Similarly, it cannot advise Renton to choose or not choose life. In fact, he does eventually choose life, though without any marked enthusiasm. I'm moving on, going straight and choosing life. I'm looking forward to it already. I'm going to be just like you. The job, the family, the big television, the washing machine, the car, the compact disc and electrical tin opener. Good health, low cholesterol, dental insurance, mortgage, starter home, leisure wear, luggage, three-piece suite. Getting by, looking ahead to the day you die. Summary. Choice involves selecting one or more items from a menu. It is explored in four contexts: that of certainty, where all items are definite; that of uncertainty, where items involve chance, either with or without given probabilities; that of strategy, where two persons' individual choices are interdependent; and that of group choice, where a number of people must choose collectively. Attitudes to risk arise in the context of uncertainty and have implications in the context of strategy. Chapter 2. Reason and Rationality. The simplest framework for choice is that in which menus consist of definite items, such as avocado and $100, from which you must choose one item or more. Ties are allowed. Recall that to say that two items tie, that is, that you choose both jointly, is just to say that you are equally content with either. Reasonable choices. Consider the following example of apparently odd choices. Hors d'oeuvres example. Your menu consists of asparagus, beetroot, and chicory. You choose asparagus. On your waiter, perhaps having misheard you, telling you that chicory is off, you choose beetroot. Your choices can be represented schematically using an obvious convention, such as ABC, A, AB, B. The problem with your choices in this example, which is in essence the sandwich example of chapter 1, is that you choose A from the full menu, but do not choose A from A and B. This does not seem right. To avoid such problems, we might require that if you choose some item from a menu and this item remains available in a more restricted menu, then you also choose it from the restricted menu. This requirement is known as the contradiction condition. It is also known as Sen's alpha property, after Amartya Sen, born 1933, the Nobel Prize-winning economist and philosopher. A racing analogy might be that if a filly wins a race which is open to both colts and fillies, then she should also win if the race is restricted to fillies. The contradiction condition has an obvious implication. Assume that there are some ties in your original choice, and that you then choose again from the smaller menu consisting of all the tied items. As is easy to see, the contradiction condition tells us that your choice does not change. This supports our allowing ties. If two items tie, then there can be no reason for choosing one rather than the other. A different type of problem arises in the next example. Soup example. Your menu seems to consist of bean and carrot soups. You choose carrot. On your waiter telling you that you've misread bean for artichoke, so that in fact the menu consists of artichoke and carrot soups, you choose both jointly, that is, they tie. On your waiter returning to announce that bean soup is indeed available, as well as the other two, you choose artichoke. Schematically, A, B, C, A, B, C, C, A, C, A, C. The problem with your choices in this example is that you choose C from B and C, and also, although not uniquely, from A and C, but do not choose C from the full menu. Again, this does not seem right. I shall say that you choose one item in a pairwise choice with a second if you choose the first, not necessarily alone, when your menu consists of just these two items. Now, to avoid the type of problem encountered in the soup example, we might require that if you choose some item in pairwise choices with every other item on the menu, then you choose it, though not necessarily it alone, from the full menu. This requirement is the expansion condition. It's also known as the Condorcet condition, after the Marquis Marie-Jean Antoine Nicolas Caritat de Condorcet, 1743-94. A mathematician and leading light of the French Enlightenment. A racing analogy here might be that if a filly beats each of a number of other fillies in two horse races, then she should also win a race whose field consists of her and these other fillies. We should check that these two conditions are consistent, in that they both can be satisfied simultaneously, and independent, in that neither implies the other. The simplest way to do this is give an example which satisfies both conditions, an example which satisfies only the first, and an example which satisfies only the second. To show that an example fails to satisfy a condition, we need only find one instance where it fails. However, to show that it satisfies a condition, we must show that the condition is satisfied in all instances, that is, by choices from all possible menus. Here is an example which satisfies both conditions, even though, as we shall see, the choices made in it still leave something to be desired. Fish example. Your menu consists of anchovies, bass and cod. You choose anchovies. But if your menu is restricted to anchovies and bass, you choose both. If to bass and cod, you choose cod. And if to anchovies and cod, you choose anchovies. Schematically, A, B, C, A, B, B, C, C, A, C, A. Note that this example specifies the choices which you make from all possible non-trivial menus. Here, you choose A, the only item which you choose from the full menu, from any restricted menu in which it is available so that the contradiction condition is satisfied. Also, A is the only item which you choose in pairwise choices with every other item so that the expansion condition is satisfied. We can use the soup example to provide an instance where the contraction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.